Good morning, everyone. My name is James Lyne, and this is Steve Sims. And we really appreciate you coming here so early in the morning to listen to us. I know that several of you are probably either very hungover or possibly actually drunk. But regardless of that, I think we have a really fun talk here. Steve and I want to go through patching exploits with duct tape, pretty unusual topic. But we want to look at some of the major changes in exploitation, some of the more modern mitigation techniques, really some of the cool stuff that's being done on the defensive side against exploits, but also some of the innovative things that exploit writers and researchers are doing to get around that, and draw some comparisons to some of the new devices and platforms that, you know, we're all starting to plug in our environments. There's some fairly technical content in here. There'll be a mixed audience in terms of experience. So please bear with us whilst we go through sometimes some terrible analogies to make it more accessible. Others will provide, you know, code on the screens that'll make it a little easier. And we'll make sure we leave time for questions as well. But if you're completely lost and it just hurts, if you could just kind of wave like this or assume the panic position, we'll know that we need to back up and do a little more. So with that, I'm going to hand over to Steve to kick us off.
Cool, thanks. And James works at Sophos, and I write exploits for a living. So they always say keep your friends close, but your enemies closer. So it's good to be friends with an AV guy when you're doing this stuff. So first, we'll talk about a little bit about the exploit sales market, which has become very popular as over the last few years. I would say 10 to 15 years ago, when I first started really diving into exploitation, there wasn't really jobs out there hiring for someone to specifically write exploits. And there certainly wasn't a way to really sell these in any ethical manner. There's always buyers out there for various exploit types, but again, ethics come into play. So zero-day exploit sales and bug bounties, very, very popular and profitable. And I put a few examples up here. Like in early 2014, Yang Yu earned $100,000 disclosing multiple exploit mitigations to Microsoft. And then CanSec West is a very popular conference each year that has a pwn-to-own challenge. Individuals and teams walk away with hundreds of thousands of dollars by working year-round on some exploits to do things like bypass the most cutting-edge exploit mitigations, such as sandboxing inside of browsers and privilege escalation. Amazing work. Again, hundreds of thousands of dollars. This one individual in particular, Hung Hoon Lee, took home over $200,000 by himself. One guy. It's usually a team. This was one guy from Korea. So amazing. Google's paid over $1 million last year alone in bug bounties. So the point is, it's very competitive. It's a lot harder now than it used to be. So people are getting smarter. The more people you have go into security, and the more that college curriculums for computer science use a lot of security in their curriculum, it's the exponential difference than 15 years ago for the number of people who are working on this stuff and who are brilliant is just mind-blowing. So we're going to focus on some of these mitigations and some of the bypass techniques.
So I want to add to that as well. Some of you in the room may be interested in security research and exploit writing explicitly. Others may be here as defenders or forensics people. And what I find really interesting is a lot of people in security look at the exploit writing stuff and go, oh, it's just for exploit writers. But a lot of this content and understanding how these things work is increasingly relevant to every one of us. And I frequently find when I'm, you know, doing defensive work that an insight into these techniques really helps me out. Now, Steve's talked about some of the fun side of bypassing this stuff. Before we kind of dive into examples of that, we need to talk about the things that get in our way. So exploit mitigation controls. I used to be the guy that would stand up 6, 7, 8 years ago and lambast Microsoft for creating a whole industry centered around some architectural deficiencies and problems. Today, I have to stand up and actually be really quite positive. I mean, they do amazing work in this area. They are making it much, much harder. And the number of occasions where you find a software fault in many applications is increasing with sloppier code. But the number of occasions where you find something like that and it can actually be used for exploitation usefully has really dropped off a cliff over the last couple of years. So in terms of our exploit mitigations, we have three kind of primary categories here. And the classic Venn diagram relationship, for those of you that like Venn diagrams, I want to draw a Venn diagram of people that like Venn diagrams and that understand Venn diagrams. So we've got application opt-in controls, things that are available for applications. Say, hey, I want to use that. Please give me this particular mitigation. Compile time controls, things that when we go and build the application, we have to say to the compiler, please turn on these canaries or cookies, for example. And OS level controls, things that the operating system supports and does on behalf of a particular application. And there's an intersection between them because, you have OS controls where, for example, ASLR is provided by the operating system, provided for by the operating system, but it's required that an application actually says that it wants to use that, so to speak. So all of these things together, and we're going to go through some specific examples in a moment, can make exploitation significantly more difficult. But as with most things in security, things are only as strong as the weakest link. If we have an application, a ton of different modules in there, and most of them are running a lot of these mitigations and one isn't, that can significantly reduce the security of the overall set. So let's have a look at a little time frame here. I also have the world's most powerful laser pointer. I actually think this might set the screen on fire, but I'm going to try it because Steve brought it, so I feel like I should use it. Look at the size of this thing. How long do the batteries take to charge? 4 days or something? No. All right. So a lot of this kicked off with, the seminal paper, Aleph 1, Smashing the Stack for Fun and Profit, all those years ago. Some of you might remember it, Frack Magazine. And we started off, seeing a lot of smashing the stack, abuse of the stack, data structure, procedure call stack in particular. And over time, people transitioned to exploitation of the heap. Things got locked down more there. People started moving on to trying to do things like use after free, which we're going to talk about in a bit, looking for weird kernel bugs. Basically, it's been a journey of manufacturers, in particular Microsoft, putting in checks and balances around key data structures and computing concepts to make this stuff harder. So you go back to Windows XP itself, and there really isn't a lot here, okay? So Windows XP, this thing is ridiculous. I have to keep moving it so it doesn't catch on fire, If I set your screen on fire, I'm really sorry. Then we came along to Windows XP SP2, and it's like a lightsaber. He nearly tattooed me the other day with it. Windows XP SP2 came along, and a lot of you might remember that because, they introduced the firewall by default. But one of the key things was DEP, Data Execution Prevention. And DEP, when it first was introduced, broke a lot of legitimate applications because a lot of developers were doing stuff like writing code into the stack and areas of memory that really should just be read-write and running it. But very quickly, people adjusted to that. Legitimate applications stopped being detected. You don't see many of those problems today. I'm not going to read through all of these concepts here, but note some of the major milestones, the more popular ones like ASLR. It's one of the ones many of you will have heard of here. We were tempted to put that in the Windows 7 column because no one used Vista. but technically, it was introduced there. And you can see a steady set of improvements in Windows 8, Windows 10, like null pointer dereferencing protection, guard pages, enhancements to the kernel, and CFG as well. So we won't go through this full set here. How many of you are familiar with DEP? Heard of it? Cool. So marking pages as read-write or saying they should be execute. Address space layout randomization, ASLR. All heard of that? Cool. So the notion that we kind of change the location of stuff so that when we're trying to find something that we can land on from an exploitation perspective, we're throwing a dart at a moving target. Security cookies, canaries, a few of you. You like talking about security cookies and canaries, don't you?
Yeah, so security cookies, as Microsoft calls them, or canaries, are kind of variables that are pushed on into memory at certain locations as a protection. So if you were to overwrite or overflow overwriting this canary, then ideally you've killed it. You've killed the canary, and during what's called the function epilogue, you're going to get caught. The idea for attackers, though, if bypass would be to, say, kill the canary, but then to kind of stuff the canary and put it back up on the perch so it still looks alive.
Like with a bicycle pump, right? Like
yeah, whatever. What is that old movie, Weekend at Bernie's? I think I saw that once in the middle of the night. I was like, I don't get it. but now I do. And then things like VT Guard, which is focused on virtual function tables and preventing attacks like use after free that we'll get into. So some of the bypass techniques, just real quickly, because we have a few demonstrations to do. Data execution prevention, again, is we don't want to execute code in regions of memory where there should be no code. So we can mark areas like the stack and the heap where we have the write permission enabled and not put the execute permission there. And then our code segment, we can have the execute permission turned on, but of course we don't want that to be writable. Things like ASLR, to bypass that, the easiest way is to identify modules that are not rebased, meaning they don't participate in any form of randomization. And then we can do things like build our return-oriented programming chain, our ROP chain, to bypass that control, to turn off DEP, essentially. Another way of ASLR is called memory leaks, or some form of a leak, or I'll demonstrate in a little bit using a custom flash object that's loaded in by the browser to basically work in tandem with a use after free bug to completely bypass ASLR, which is really, really cool stuff. So again, we don't want to go through every one of these, but they're up here, and of course you can look them up a little bit later. So James will do a quick demo now.
With the world's most confusing mouse, this is horrible. You know those little things in the middle of the keyboard that you can use to drive it? Have you ever met anyone that actually uses that?
Yeah, see?
What are you talking? Come on. Really? Oh, don't support him. Do you want to unlock?
You know what the password is? Come on. You can figure that one out.
Is this? Wait. It is. Awesome. All right. So what we've got here is a pretty simple exploit, actually. We're not going to go too much through the actual details. It's an older one. I went through some of the usage of this in a presentation the other day. It's an object confusion attack in RTF, specifically focusing on Microsoft Word 2010 SP2. And we've just taken the Metasploit payload generator, created an RTF file, and now we have a handler waiting and listening for this guy to connect back. So over here, wrong VM. Over here, I have.
It's in its own pane.
Oh, you separated it out? Oh, God, that's so confusing and horrible. Okay. Over here, I got a little Windows 7 system set up and ready to run. The key thing that we quickly want to demonstrate here is that things aren't always as perfect as they seem. I mean, we talked about all these mitigations. Obviously, different manufacturers and vendors will kind of implement these compile time controls progressively. It's astonishing how some very mainstream applications, like Dropbox, took a really long time to get ASLR enabled and to support rebasing. But obviously, Microsoft has put in a lot of effort into making sure that everything works correctly, that they're using all these mitigations. So let's just open up Word here. And what we're going to do is just use the awesome Mona by Corlan Coda. Why can we not find that? Oh, there it is. I'm making idiotic typos. I know this is really small on the screen here. We're just loading in PYKD, PY Mona modules. So this is neat. What this does is it goes through and it looks at all the loaded modules in this particular application, and it gives us a series of columns that shows us the protection status. So we've got like safe SEH, rebase, ASLR, NX compat. And we can scroll down and see that generally speaking, things are pretty good. Now, ASLR is probably one of the ones we're most interested in, because if we're going to go and generate a ROP chain to disable DEP and get into our payload, we're going to need something static that we can trampoline off. And a quick review of this shows that there's not really anything here that we can use. Let's go fire the exploit, and I just want to show you that things aren't always as simple as they may seem. So I'm going to open up Awesome 8, and Word does something which happens approximately 50 times a day, which is crash. Now, if we skip back over to our other virtual machine here, you'll see we have a meterpreter session. Woo! Awesome. So we now got a nice little backdoor. I was very enthusiastic about that interpreter. It's early. I haven't had all my coffee yet. And we now have control over the system, which is great. Let's skip back and attach the debugger to our now compromised office and have a look at how things have changed. There are a few opportunities for static trampolines here, depending on what other software you have installed. When we did this on one of your VMs, we found a DLL, what was it? It was like the thin print driver or something?
Yeah. Very common for third-party applications, ones that you would never think would do any harm, to inject themselves into another process. Like the other day, I was using Camtasia to record a session, and I was debugging some browser, and I was like, why are there Camtasia modules loaded into the browser? That's what gets you into trouble.
Antivirus, another good example. That's your favorite Blaze media player. All right. So let me show you the one that is specifically a great opportunity here. MSCOMCTL.OCX. You see that whole run of falses until the end there? And we don't care about NX Compact because we're recycling code that's legitimately already loaded into memory and marked as executable. So this is a nice static trampoline that these guys use. It's actually Microsoft code. It's not a third-party supplied one. You just have to create the right conditions to get this guy to load, and then you can use it. So even with Microsoft, things aren't always as perfect as they seem. There have only been demonstrations of this particular exploit and this set of conditions against this particular version of Office, although it didn't take long to recreate this on Office 2013 using some of the techniques that we may talk through here. So that shows you that things aren't always perfect. Now, Microsoft has done a lot of work to make things better in high-value targets. And obviously, one of the highest-value targets for cybercriminals, for people wanting to deploy malware, is the browser. I mean, Adobe's had a really bad time at the beginning of this year. Flash has been slammed on. Internet Explorer, had a lot of pain through last year and the year before that. So Microsoft went about going beyond the standard mitigations that they do for all their applications and started getting a little more smart on these targeted apps. So, for example, with Internet Explorer, the June patch here, we got isolated heaps. So for sensitive objects, things that are the higher risk for things like use after free that we're coming on to shortly, we move them out of the standard process heap into an isolated heap to reduce the risk. We've also got, in this July patch, additional memory protection to help protect freeing of objects with a delayed release. Now, neither of these things are perfect, as we're going to go on to demonstrate. Right? Protected free can be bypassed by meeting the release threshold. Isolated heaps, by setting up memory the right way, we can find proper-sized objects to trick it into recycling things and get control as we'd like. But it makes things a lot harder, and you need the right conditions to be able to bypass this stuff. There's a whole load more examples of this, but one of the most recent kind of bleeding edge ones that I think is really awesome, well, it's really awesome if you're not trying to write exploits, it's really awesome and really clever is Control Flow Guard. It's a new protection coming in Windows 10 or Windows 8 Update 3, though it has to be compiled in. What it does is essentially creates a bitmap that looks at the start address of each function. So think of it as a map of normal flow of execution through an application. And if you deviate from that, right, if you try and pivot off somewhere else to execute your own code, even by recycling existing code in memory, it's going to go, that's not right. You shouldn't be doing a call to that. That's not what this application does. Again, I mean, there has been a bypass of that already. Someone found a flag, didn't they? But this is going to make life significantly more difficult. It's really clever and a great example of Microsoft kind of leading the charge on making life harder for exploit writers. Which leads us to an area where none of this applies.
Yeah, so the Internet of Things, very popular topic lately. If anyone remembers Dave Vitale from Immunity Security's rant not too long ago, I had a really good laugh over that one.
Junk hacking.
Junk hacking, yes. So basically, we're focused heavily on what's profitable as exploit writers. So things like browsers, like Adobe, client-side applications that are very popular make the most sense. So that's where all of our talent is focused. When you go to something like, and by the way, I put this up here, good conversation with the wife in the past about don't fuzz the baby monitor whilst traveling. When it doesn't work, when you have a toddler or baby at home, that's not a smart idea.
Of course, you never did that. Did
no.
The dumbest thing I've ever fuzzed, I bought a load of Internet of Things devices, and the weirdest one, what you could use to water plants whilst you're away. So, of course, you know, you start kind of cramming random data in it. The thing starts watering, and I can't get it to stop. Like running around trying to stop it from flooding things.
Yeah, so typically, the more obscure an operating system or device, I mean, all these things out there, junk, like you could say, they weren't meant to be connected to the internet, right? But then you start plugging this stuff in, then obviously people are going to start attacking it. So it's kind of like the new low-hanging fruit are all these random things out there that we are now connecting to the internet. So it's really, really fun.
Old versions of Linux, Android, I mean, I don't know why they use such old versions of Linux. It's weird. Maybe it's a size thing or...
Well, one thing I've always said is, you know, I use this analogy sometimes where say you were going to Stanford and you were getting your PhD in computer science and you came up with a brilliant idea and your professors are saying you should pitch this to venture capitalists or angel funding. And they say, okay, we're going to approve this and give you $1 million to develop this application or product. When you're spending this 6 months, year, however long it takes building it, things start getting really stressful at the end. The day before release, you're not going to go and upgrade the kernel. That doesn't sound like a good idea. You release this, you harden it, and then you hope that no one realizes it's Linux kernel 2.4 under the hood. So we're now going to get into a little bit of use after free, only because the demonstrations we're going to talk about or show soon are really use after free bugs. So I'm going to go through the technical definition of what this is, and then I'm going to hand it over to James. I made this analogy, and I was like, I would never be able to pull this off. I don't have the cool accent. And if it goes wrong, then you'll forgive him. But you probably would be like, I hate that guy if it was me. So we'll get there in a moment. So use after free, from a high level, is we allocate memory, and then if that memory is still in use by the application but gets prematurely deleted or freed, when the application goes to use it, what happens? It crashes, potentially. Or if an attacker can corrupt memory and take control of that freed area of memory, they can gain control of execution, potentially. So this is more of a C++ bug with object-oriented programming, where you have a C++ class. And if this class uses virtual functions, when we instantiate an object, an instance of that class, it has something called virtual pointer, a vpointer. It's a hidden class member that basically gets created and written into the object when it's created. It points to something called a virtual function table. And the virtual function table is basically a list of functions or methods that can take action on this particular object that was created. So what we want to do is identify a condition where an application prematurely frees memory, and then we want to determine the size of that object in memory and do another allocation to replace it. It's very, very profitable. Memory corruption bugs and kernel bugs are very popular. And this is why there's such a focus on mitigating this memory corruption vulnerability class. $10,000 to $20,000 per exploitable use after free bug with remote code execution from an ethical buyer is pretty normal. Now, when I say ethical, you can kind of try to figure out what that means. Unethical would be the weird people that show up with a briefcase and hand it over and you give them this exploit, which can yield sometimes over $100,000 for a single bug. These bugs are so popular because, one, they're powerful and they're difficult to detect through static analysis. Static analysis, if you use tools like Fortify and others that basically scan the source code and try and identify potential bugs, those are great. You should use them. But they're limited in that they can't really see how the application behaves once it's compiled and once it's there at runtime. You can't, as a developer, account for all the different scenarios under which your application may run. So very, very lucrative. Basics, so again, when an object is created and uses virtual functions, it gets something called a virtual pointer. This pointer points to a virtual function table. When a virtual function is called, I'm going to walk through basically a high-level example of the code. It dereferences, which means we go to the object's address and we grab something that's stored at that location, and we load it into a processor register that will allow us to then identify the virtual function that we want to call and then call it. So here's kind of a short diagram. If you're not familiar with processor registers, they're basically little pieces of memory, little hard-coded variables that are integrated into the processor. So in this step one here, we're moving into something called the accumulator register. The virtual pointer, the brackets around where it says ECX, is basically the pointer to the object, and we want to take the virtual pointer out of that object, load it into a register. Now we have a pointer to the virtual function table. And remember what this virtual function table does. It holds, as you can see on the right, where it says VTable, these are all slots at different offset, offset 0, offset 4, offset 8. They're different pointers for functions that we may want to call to take action on this particular allocation, this object. So that's what you're seeing in step two. We've determined what offset this pointer feels so weak compared to that one.
Yeah, you need to use this, yeah.
So any of these offsets, what we're doing here is saying dereference from the virtual pointer an offset to that into an appropriate register, a designated register, and then we call that virtual function. This would be an example of us exploiting the object. So again, the object for some reason has been prematurely freed. We need to identify the size of that object and replace it after it's been freed. We replace it with something malicious, and that way when this code goes through and does that whole dereferencing and we've got the pointer to the virtual function table, we have control of that. We can tell it to point wherever we want. So now I'm going to hand it over to James to do a more high level.
So some of you may have followed that example. You get it perfectly. Bear with me a few seconds here. For those of you that found that a little confusing, if there were newer concepts, this may help, or it may be terrible. But anyway, you've got Frodo the hamster here. Okay, I'm guessing a few of you have kids. They have pets. Maybe you have a hamster called Frodo. Now, Frodo the hamster is your daughter or son's favorite pet, and unfortunately, the hamster dies. It's always kind of morbid when an analogy starts with a dying hamster, I know, but it gets better. So the hamster dies, and unfortunately, you know that when your kid gets back from school and they find this dead hamster, they're going to be really, really sad, and no one wants a screaming clip art girl. I mean, that's just terrible. So to avoid this particular problem, we do what any responsible parent would do, and you go to the pet store, right? You've done this? You know what I'm talking about? Some of you just look angry. All right, so we go to the pet store, and we buy a new hamster, and we want this new hamster to look as similar as possible to Frodo, because we're hoping that, she's not going to notice. But instead of Frodo, we get this evil hamster. Right? It took a lot of Googling to find the evil hamster, didn't it? So we get this evil hamster, and we put it in the place of the original hamster. Awesome. Essentially, we've replaced this object with an evil, replaced this hamster with an evil hamster, which is akin to our object replacement we described before. Does that kind of make sense? Are you following the concept of what we're trying to do here? Yeah? Cool. Okay. So let's dive into a couple of demonstrations of this and the effect that some of the mitigations can have.
Yep. So basically, this is a exploit from 2013. It was discovered discovered in the wild being used by FireEye. And this particular one was targeting, I believe, the the Veterans Affairs, Department of Veterans Affairs and such. So a lot of these USAP, their free bugs, are very targeted attacks. So what they'll do is identify a zero day, meaning a bug that has not been disclosed and no one else knows about it, and they'll find a vulnerable website and they'll upload somehow, SQL injection or whatever else, they'll get their exploit onto this public website. And depending on who you're targeting, it makes sense to go after certain organizations because the visitors of that website are your target. So what happens is people go to this website, and if they're running a vulnerable version of the browser or application, then they get compromised potentially, and now we've got our foothold in that organization or on that system. So this one here, I'll do a quick demonstration.
Should point out as well, these kinds of bugs are the ones that are going to end up in, you know, exploit kits for sale. They're the things driving a lot of the malware distribution market. But they are also becoming more rare and more valuable, as Steve highlighted earlier, which is changing a few of the dynamics of that market and driving up the price of these bugs and driving them to be used for more specific targeted affairs than the broad gangbuster approach that you would have traditionally seen.
So real quickly, I'm just showing you what's called the trigger file. This is basically, through fuzzing or some other testing, an attacker will identify an exploitable condition, a potentially exploitable condition. Usually we come up with a crash, and the browser crashes, and we don't necessarily know why. So using a very specific set of testing, we can identify that it is an exploitable bug. So this is an example of just enough code that would cause the browser to crash. To identify these types of bugs, we do things that no developer would ever do in the code. We try to create strange allocations, and then we free these allocations, and we do things that are not normal. And we're hoping that, hey, this wasn't tested for by quality assurance, or it was not caught in the SDL in your organization.
You're typically looking for like more unusual functionality that people will have touched less, and like look for surface area that is likely to yield less tested results.
Exactly. So if you look at something like quality assurance, I mean, if we use Microsoft Office, most of us use a very small subset of the functionality and features in that application. As an attacker, I want to go for the more obscure stuff. And that's why when I send you some weird document, not me, James, send you some weird document and you open it up, it's usually doing something strange that's very, very abnormal. So in this example, I've got I'm going to run this loop here. And this is checking to see if port 4444 is open, which means it's a socket, basically. Your computer, if it opens this port, is now listening and awaiting an incoming connection. Or, of course, we can have it go in the opposite direction. Yes, backdoor. Now, I'm going to run this exploit. As you can see, these are just HTML files. So if I was to do this in the wild, I would have this HTML file hosted somewhere. All you have to do is visit it in your browser, and it should open up the port. So we run the exploit, and now the port's open. So all you had to do is view that page, and now we have access to your system. And this is why USAP to free and other memory corruption bugs like type confusion and such are very, very lucrative. That easy. We have access to your system. So that's an example of one USAP to free exploit. Now, EMET or EMET or EMET, however you want to pronounce it, we all love the phonetic pronunciation of acronyms, right?
Like EMET.
This is a fantastic product that Microsoft's been offering for years. Now, to be honest, when it first came out, it was not easy to configure and administer, and it broke a lot of applications. I kind of say it's, you know, Microsoft's test bed for new exploit mitigations that maybe have not been vetted yet. And we want to, it's an optional thing. You can download this for free, run it in your organization. You have to test it to make sure it doesn't break your applications. But it's so powerful that it can stop the majority of zero days. Now, when I say that, I mean zero days that aren't really customized or tailored for your organization.
I should point out as well, Steve made a really good point here. A lot of people were scared off by that first version. Like, oh, EMET, I mean, that's never going to work in my environment. I'm not locked down or controlled enough. The later versions are really good. You still do need to test it, but there's actually very good central configuration. Like, you can deploy policies. You can deploy it selectively on high-risk applications that are well-tested. You don't have to go broad on the system.
Yep.
I mean, this is really one of the things I would consider a mandatory core control in any environment using Windows. You just deploy it selectively if you're concerned about a broader application.
Yeah, so if you at least turn this on for Internet Explorer if your organization is using that. Adobe, Microsoft Office, you have blocked the majority of exploits out there. I don't remember the exact number, so don't hold me to this directly, but it was something like Microsoft tested 184, I think that's the number, exploits against an unpatched version of Windows. So essentially, how vulnerable is this operating system to these 0 days? Because we haven't patched it. And almost all of them worked. And then they put Emmet on it, or Emmet, and it blocked all but like 10. So it really, really does a great job at stopping these exploits attempts.
And it's free.
And it's free. Unfortunately, it has a very low adoption rate, meaning that most organizations just don't use it. I mean, a couple years ago, I remember it was around 5% were the stats that I heard, which is it was small. Now, it's not to say that it can't be bypassed. Last year, right at RSA, Jared DeMott, I believe, did a presentation at B-Sides demonstrating that you could bypass version 4. And then Microsoft comes out with a new version trying to fix some of the problems that are there. Remember, this is defense in depth. It's all about any one control may fail, so we want lots of them, at least to slow down the attacker so we can detect it before they're successful. So this is going to be a quick EMET demonstration. I'm going to go back to the same system where we just ran this use after free bug. And we're going to turn on Emmet.
They made the user interface a lot nicer as well.
Yes, it's way better. So here is, and I'll zoom in, kind of the main page that comes up. Now, some of these are system exploit mitigations, and other ones we can go into a specific application. So we click on apps, and I only have Internet Explorer running right now with Emmet protection. And that's the great thing about it. It's granular. You can choose just one or two applications, and you can even go further than that. It's not like you have to enable everything. If you find that a particular protection is not working with your application or you deem it less important, you can turn that one off. What I'll do now is simply turn on one extra control. So as you can see, we got around some of them with our last exploit. We turn on one control. This is called stack pivot protection. Basically, there are certain processor registers that belong in certain areas of memory. And if we steal it away because it helps us with our exploit and point it to somewhere where it should not be pointed, then this will detect it. So all we did was turn on one additional control.
Should mention as well, whilst Steve's doing that, the audit-only mode, that was a later addition. That's pretty neat as well to actually have a view that something maybe has gone wrong. You can deploy that in your environment, collect stats about whether legitimate applications are doing it, or at least get an early warning trigger on people doing an exploit for those of you that don't want to go as far as actually blocking this stuff. It's pretty neat.
Yep. So now I'll run that exact same exploit. And it still worked for some odd reason. That was not a good thing. It shows you that it's not perfect. I'm not a salesman.
Let's try that one more time.
Let me kill this again. What I'll
Ladies
do
Ladies and gentlemen, if you could just look over here. I've got this giant laser pointer on the ceiling. It's very shiny. It's Maybe Internet Explorer is running in the background still. I didn't fully terminate because it only applies when it reopens the process, right?
We are those crazy people that like to challenge the demo gods.
Maybe you should just turn everything.
That's exactly what I was going to say. Oh, it didn't take it. That's all it was. It
turn
didn't
up.
Take it.
Oh, okay.
So I'm going to do this again. We'll say okay. I think I hit cancel.
Turn up.
Refresh.
To
all right, there we go. Now it's working. So we'll run that same thing again. And there we go. Emmet, as you can see, caught it. And the port, it's still open from before, but it did not work. So that demonstrates that it is very, very useful. It stopped that attack from being successful.
Bypass time.
What I'm going to do, we're not going to bypass EMET right now, but we're going to bypass something else in a moment. So I'm going to revert to a different demonstration. While that's happening, we'll go back here. So this demonstration I'm going to show is a ASLR bypass. This one is going to be Internet Explorer 10, where everything, remember James just a moment ago showed you the tool Mona from Corelancoder, and it showed all the different modules and the protections that ran on each one. In this example, there are no unsafe modules. Everything is fully protected, meaning at compile time, the developer ensured that ASLR was enabled for these modules. Now, what this demonstration will do is use a flash object. So you can use something called ActionScript, and you can compile that into a shockwave file to a flash object. Then you can have the browser load that in via a custom web page. And this particular exploit is really neat. It's another use after free bug. This one, though, makes a call. Let me start at a different location here. Step one, you go to the bad web page with the vulnerable browser, which is IE10. By the way, last I heard just a couple months ago, Internet Explorer 8 was still the most popular version of Internet Explorer. That's horrible. I know some of you are like, yeah, we're using that one. Cool. So Internet Explorer 10, though, you visit the page, and it loads this flash file, and it sprays memory. It's something called heap spraying, if you've heard that term before. We use, basically, these sound objects in flash to just keep creating objects over and over and over again, filling up memory. What we're trying to do is extend the memory allocations to a predictable location so that we can then make an external call to a JavaScript function that triggers a useAfterFree bug that writes to this predictable location in memory and modifies a size variable. This modification of size variable allows ActionScript full access to the memory. So your flash object now has full access to memory, and it's able to locate the randomized modules. It basically searches through memory to find them. Once it finds them, it dynamically creates what's called a ROP chain on the fly, and bypasses ASLR, and we win. It's pretty neat stuff. So I'll demonstrate this real quick.
You also win points by virtue of the fact that you're heap spraying with flash and sound.
Yes.
It's just, there's something elegant and beautiful about that.
And a neat thing about this one is it checked to see whether or not EMET was enabled. So it didn't bypass it, though we can bypass EMET. It checked to see if it was enabled, and if it detected it, basically it does this by looking at the file system with JavaScript to see if the emit DLL is there. And if it sees it, it says, I'm not going to exploit you, bro. And it moves on. So it's pretty neat.
Does it literally put out that string?
It says, bro. So we click on trigger. Now, this one's not as exciting. It's going to bring up everyone's favorite payload, a calculator.
It's my favorite payload. Or Portuguese notepad. I like that one, too.
When you're demonstrating exploitation, sometimes just showing code execution by popping up a calculator is very common. So we click on this trigger file. And right now, it's spraying the heap. And we've got this external call that you would not normally have in an exploit saying, payload is built. And I'm hoping it pops up.
I wait to the day till I see that, like, on a web page. You browse there, and it's like, exploiting now.
Well, in this case, it just crashed, but that's very common with exploitation. So we'll go ahead and give it one more try.
It's interesting to note that over time, the reliability of exploits has become more challenging, hasn't it? And the definition of an excellent exploit runs most of the time, as opposed to the older days where you'd get quite a high degree of perfection.
I'm going to do one more attempt on this guy to revert back to the same snapshot. And then we'll move on if this doesn't work. But essentially, why it's taking so long is it's doing exactly what I said. It's spraying memory, and then it's going to bypass ASLR, and it sometimes can take a little bit of time. But users have a threshold. They'll wait, you know, a couple minutes.
The other thing is, you'll often, when you see these things, when you see an exploit that's going to take time, it'll often be embedded, you know, in the background, like they'll drop it into an iframe or a div, or they'll do some form of include, or, you know, something that shows a bit more of the page and invokes a bit more patience, as opposed to this more raw example for analysis purposes.
Well, this one's looking like it wants to be stubborn, but that's okay. You get the concept, and we'll show one more here in a moment. Wait, last chance. Do it.
Oh, no.
Oh! Calculator!
Yeah! That was... I love the, like, sympathetic round of applause there. It's like, yeah, that's good.
So real quickly, bypassing isolated heap, we got a few more minutes. The group Keen Team, another group of brilliant folks who are researchers, exploit writers, they found a bypass technique. They were looking at what James described earlier, protected or deferred free. and then the isolated heaps. And this particular technique is a little bit complex, so we're quickly going to walk through it. James is going to use paint, because he's a Mac user. I am too sometimes, but it's much funnier to see him draw with paint. You'll see.
All right.
So the first thing we're doing here is, oh, you're cheating.
Oh, no, I won't cheat. Wait a minute, let's use an actual brush here. Let's do it. All right, okay. All right.
So the first thing we're doing here is creating something called the process heap. This is the heap that is created at runtime for the application. This is historically, let's say, in a browser where all those HTML objects, when I say objects, I mean things like the image tag, things like a C button element, things like a table. Those are all elements. And they're normally put in the process heap. And this is where use after free comes into play. We identify a condition where memory gets prematurely freed, and we know that we can make an allocation to that exact location where it previously existed. Isolated heaps, then, is for sensitive objects, critical objects. They're put into a separate memory location. And the whole idea behind that is if there is a use after free bug, it's less likely that an attacker will be able to get an allocation into that isolated area. So the research really is to look for a bypass. So what the Keen team did from a high level is they created four ctitle objects, so these different objects, and then they deleted the offset 2. So basically they freed offset 2. The whole reason for this is we delete a memory allocation that is equal to the size of the object that's involved in the use after free bug. So we know it's going to be allocated there. Then what happens is we trigger the use after free bug, or at least the premature free, and then we force a coalesce to occur. We want that memory on the right side to be coalesced into one big block of memory. That's a normal heap operation. And then we create another object to fill that location that is in the isolated heap. So that's kind of what I'm going to demonstrate here.
I used orange for the bad stuff. You like that? That was the most difficult thing I've done all day. Was it better than the hamster? You guys liked the hamster, didn't you? Yeah, a little bit?
Terrible. So this right here shows you, this is basically in the constructor, basically the creation of the element, showing you that isolated heap is there. That means that this particular object will be allocated into an isolated heap. And we can also see the size of that object. This stuff is very important in use after free and just general exploitation. So we go over to this Windows 8 box. This is Windows 8 with Internet Explorer 11. Over on the left-hand side is the code that I'll walk through real briefly in a moment here. Now, this one isn't very impressive when it dies, but what you'll see is that we get control of a register that we should never be able to get control of because isolated heaps should have protected us. But when we run this, the postmortem debugger should kick in a moment here. And there's the postmortem debugger. We zoom in, and you can see that that is 42424242. That's BBBB. That is intentionally there to show us that we've been successful. And this demonstrates that we've bypassed isolated heap, which is very neat. So let me quickly...
Stuck in the magnifier.
Walk through a little bit of the code. What James so beautifully drew a moment ago is essentially what's happening here. We're up in this top area. This pointer feels so weak. Up in this top area, you can see that 100,000. That's supposed to be a threshold to bypass deferred free. In this case, you don't really need that, but there is a threshold that says don't release the memory until a very large allocation is then freed. Below that, we're creating a bunch of title objects, and this is to avoid coalescing at first, and then we're punching a hole. Right there is where we're punching the hole, down at the bottom.
I kind of broke it.
Right there is where we're punching a hole. These are the allocations, and then we're punching a hole at that location. And then here, we are, after the use after free bug has been triggered, we're doing the intentional deletion of those other objects to force a coalesce to occur. And then we go in and create this new area element, and we set its properties And we know where it's going to be located because we created the memory that was used by the bug in the first place. So again, it gets a little advanced and complex, in this, especially in this short amount of time. But you should get the point, and I already showed the demo there.
So a few things for you to consider. Firstly, I hope that a few of you were interested by a few of these techniques and want to learn more about them. A lot of security professionals run away from this stuff and think it's exploit-only territory. But I think increasingly this is valuable to everyone. I mean, I know a lot of penetration testers that have perfected some of these skills, not enough to write their own exploits, but to be able to patch like an exploit from the Metasploit project to make it work in one of their penetration tests.
Or even know what defenses should we put out there. If your domain administrator does not understand the benefits of data execution prevention, they may not push that out with GPO.
Yeah. You also should consider the devices outside of the Microsoft world and their respective level of mitigation and targeting. I mean, I've been ripping apart a lot of these devices, and it's astonishing how many just don't have even rudimentary protections. Like, we're bringing ourselves back to the dark ages of computing, you know, in pre-Windows XP era in many cases. So, yeah, I mean, consider all those things holistically. If you have your own applications, make sure that your SDL includes this stuff. And we hope that you enjoyed that presentation. We did our best to make it accessible and entertaining. Again, really appreciate you turning up so early in the morning to see this, and we hope that we'll see you somewhere soon doing your own bypass.
Yep, and thank you. And if you have any questions, just feel free to come on up here afterward and talk to us.
Ping us on Twitter. Thanks, everyone.
Thanks.